Debate season is a lot like duck hunting season. A lot of waiting, followed by brief, violent action. I've never hunted a duck. Close your eyes and imagine this. You're in a conversation with nine other people. All of you want to have your say about every issue that gets brought up in that conversation. Inevitably, there's a lot of crosstalk and plenty of times where you simply cannot get a word in edgewise. You'd very likely leave that conversation frustrated and more than a little bit annoyed at the other nine people who just wouldn't shut up. Now, open those eyes. And consider that the 10-person conversational jam I just outlined is exactly what the 20, yes, I said 20, men and women debating in the early stages of the 2020 Democratic presidential race are dealing with. Now that, plus the added pressure of their conversation being broadcast to, you know, millions of people, and the certain knowledge that a poor performance could doom their chances of becoming President of the United States, kind of a big deal, makes the debates an incredibly difficult moment for even the most battle-tested of the candidates. So, how can you stand out in a good way given all of these challenges? I'm here with a few pieces of advice. Piece of advice number one, pick your spots. It's easy to assume that the way to stand out on a crowded debate stage is to interject in absolutely every conversation for the duration of the debate. But, like lots of easy assumptions, that one is dead wrong. Take the cases of Kirsten Gillibrand and Eric Swalwell in the first debates back in June. Both of them went into the debate with an "I am going to talk as much as possible at every moment" approach. Swalwell, the California congressman, just kept interrupting conversations between the other candidates to say, "pass the torch," his attempt to make clear it was time for a new generation of Democratic leaders. Gillibrand, a senator from New York, would jump into conversations insisting she had an important and relevant point to make. But instead, she would just regurgitate boilerplate stuff from her stump speech. Not so great. Swalwell dropped out of the race in July after it became crystal clear that he was not going to qualify for the second debate sponsored by CNN in Detroit. Gillibrand saw zero bump in her numbers and her campaign continues to fight for its political life. So the better way to stand out is to actually pick your spots. Find a place where one of your main opponents has a weakness. Look for a moment to exploit it and then go, go, go. Go, it's four goes. California Senator Kamala Harris executed this strategy to perfection in the first debate. She laid in wait for former Vice President Joe Biden. When the topic turned to race, Harris went for it, hammering Biden for his opposition to busing as a means to end segregation.
Civil rights, by the way, include not just only African-Americans, but the LGBT community.
But Vice President Biden, do you agree today that you were wrong to oppose busing in America?
Biden, clearly not ready for that attack, stumbled and bumbled his way into an answer of sorts. The whole back and forth probably took 3 minutes or less of actual debate talking time, but a moment was made, and Harris saw her standing in the post-debate polls shoot upwards. The second piece of advice on how to stand out in a debate is to make sure you deliver your signature line clearly and with maximum effect. So don't fool yourself, and sorry, Mom, all candidates come into presidential debates with a handful of one-liners pre-written that they are looking to employ at exactly the right time. Sometimes that right moment never materializes. Often there is a moment though, and if you miss it, it doesn't come around again. So the platonic ideal of just this kind of missed opportunity is Tim Pawlenty, the former Republican governor of Minnesota. In the run-up to one of the early debates in the 2012 Republican presidential primary process, Pawlenty signaled he was going to go after frontrunner Mitt Romney's healthcare plan, dubbing it, wait for it, Obamacare. That's pretty good, right? Oh, it's Obama, Romney. In the debate itself, though, CNN's John King asked Pawlenty a question about healthcare and what he had said about Romney's past work on the issue in Massachusetts. And Pawlenty flinched.
Your rival is standing right there. If it was Obamacare on Fox News Sunday, why is it not Obamacare standing here with the governor right there?
President Obama is the person who I quoted in saying he looked to Massachusetts for designing his program. He's the one who said it's a blueprint and that he merged the two programs. And so using the term Obamacare was a reflection of the president's comments that he designed Obamacare on the Massachusetts healthcare plan.
That was it. His campaign never really recovered. Now, on the other side, the flip side of the equation for this is Ronald Reagan during the 1984 campaign against Minnesota Senator Walter Mondale. Reagan, who was in his early 70s, was battling questions about whether he was too old to run for a second term. In the second debate between the two men, the question of age came up, and Reagan was ready. Quote, "I want you to know that also, I will not make age an issue of this campaign. I am not going to exploit, for political purposes, my opponent's youth and inexperience," Reagan said with a wry smile. With those two sentences, Reagan won that debate and ensured age was off the table as an issue in the campaign. Now, one final piece of advice on how to stand out in these crowded debates. Be yourself. Sounds easy, but it's very difficult to stay within yourself when you know what's at stake and you feel the pressure to perform. But voters have a very highly trained BS meter. So don't try to be Mr. Funny Guy or girl if that's not your personality. Don't inject yourself into conversations in the debates where you don't know your position backwards and forwards. Don't go beyond your established views. You do you. I feel like a self-help guru. It's very easy to give advice like this and much harder to take it. The candidates on these debate stages are doing a high wire act with no net. One slip and, well, could be all over. The best way to deal with all that pressure is to not think about it all that much. Be in the moment, find your opportunities, and execute on them. It's actually very simple, in theory. And that is The Point. We make new Point episodes every Tuesday and Thursday. Check them all out.